Liz.
Thank you, Dwayne. Appreciate the introduction. And I want to thank the committee for inviting me to give this talk, and hopefully it'll be productive and useful for multiple purposes. So without further ado, today I'm going to give a quick overview of dengue diagnostic test for dengue, talk about immunodiagnostic tests as far as differential diagnostics, a little bit about NS1, a single specimen testing algorithm that we published in recently, and a serosurvey diagnostic for past immunity. So I think one of the biggest challenges that we have with dengue diagnostics is how do we design a diagnostic test that's accurate, rapid, sensitive, and standardized when we have multiple flaviviruses circulating. Let's see how you work to see. Oh. Multiple flaviviruses circulating throughout the world, as Dwayne had mentioned before, as well as now we have, Zika in multiple regions of the world. And as we talked about before, phylogenetically speaking, the cross-reactivity actually occurs between serocomplex groups, such as West Nile virus, the JE serocomplex group, which constitutes West Nile virus, St. Louis encephalitis, as well as the cross-reactivity that you observe between dengue viruses. These cross-react with each other. The serocomplexes can cross-react as well, however, not as strongly as you see within each serocomplex group. So what complicates matters with dengue is not just the cross-reactivity between all the different flaviviruses, but also requires the development of diagnostics to take into account genotypes, and we have multiple genotypes by serotype. And this has actually been shown to be challenging even in molecular assays. So the other complication is the fact that you see different kinetics as far as virus, antibody, antigen tests based on primary and secondary infections. So in primary infections, you'll see that dengue virus NS1, you can detect anywhere between 10 to 14 days post-onset of illness. This is onset of fever versus sensitivity. This is just a cartoon depicting what you typically would see in the kinetics of these two, of either a primary dengue virus infection or a secondary or subsequent dengue virus infection. However, NS1 then becomes truncated in its ability to be detected due to serocomplex groups that form. And that has to do with this incredible anamnestic response by IgG that you observe in secondary infections. Whereas in primary infections, you see this IgG coming up around 9 to 10 days post-onset of fever. And then the other difference here is the fact that you have this IgM response that persists up to 3 months in some cases in primary infections, and you don't often see this persistence in secondary infections. Now, most of the antibody is made against the envelope protein. You have 180 envelope proteins in every viral particle, so that's really where most of the antibodies are actually produced. But they're also produced against many of the structural genes as well as all of the other non-structural gene products. So to rule in or rule out dengue, you must ask yourself the following questions. And the problem with dengue diagnostics nowadays is that people who try to do diagnostics have no understanding of the kinetics of the virus, antigen, and antibody. And so they're not really using the right test. So are you testing the correct analyte given the patient's onset of illness? You see people testing for PCR day 10, really wasting a lot of reagents. Are there more than one analyte you should measure? Is a test a confirmatory test? Are there other flavivirus co-circulating that could cross-react if you're using an immunodiagnostic test? And can you further confirm your testing? So I'm not going to go through this in detail, but as we all know, virus identification and RNA detection are probably your gold standards as far as confirming a flavivirus infection. And I think what worries me nowadays is that isolation of virus is becoming rarer. I worry about the younger generation not knowing how to isolate a flavivirus at this point, or even dengue, which is quite difficult. But you need quite a bit of expertise. RNA detection you know, I've gotten a lot of pushback by molecular biologists saying there's no contamination in PCR. But if you go into these low to middle income countries and they're starting their PCR testing, often they don't have the clean rooms and the different rooms and containments to stop contamination. This is still a potential problem in those particular laboratories. Antigen detection, specifically NS1, has gotten better. It's easy to perform with an ELISA or a rapid test. It's fairly inexpensive in comparison to PCR. But we don't know right now with the cross-reactivity as far as with Zika and other co-circulating flaviviruses. It tends to be much more specific. And then, of course, we have the issues with antibody detection. And at one point, we were saying seroconversion gives us in paired samples tells us that it's a confirmed case, but it's only a confirmed flavivirus case. We can't say it's a confirmed dengue case. And we aren't the only ones that have problems with diagnostics. The clinicians also have issues. So there's a lot of infectious etiologies out there that look like dengue. So then you have to worry about, as if physicians tell you, well, I think it's a dengue case, but it's actually malaria or lepto or some other type of infectious disease that are dengue lookalikes. So in the diagnostic field, we rely on the first line of defense, which is the physician who is identifying the case and giving us some direction on which diagnostic to actually run. And this is also another issue. So I think it'd be prudent for me to talk about immunodiagnostics tests in this particular forum. So many in the audience probably think that the evolution of immunodiagnostics tests has been slow and not really evolving as well as we would expect. We went from the HI assay, human agglutination inhibition assay, to then being able to, which is not isotype specific, then going to the ELISA assay, which then we can detect the isotypes, and then of course the lateral flow assay or some utility and point of care tests, and the microsphere immunoassay, which is a much more sophisticated test. There are many other tests out there, and I'm not saying that this is it, but they're still in development, like microfluidics, nanotechnology, et cetera. They're exciting, they're new, they're interesting, yet not developed really for utility in the public health arena. But we still can't get away with the issue of cross-reactivity. This is a study that was done in 2009. This is a multi-country study with seven different countries. And what I like about this study, and I referenced it quite a bit because it's one of the few studies that looks at seven different countries that provide serum specimens representing different geographical zones. So we have laboratories in Asia and laboratories in the Americas. And we could actually, and then we had, of course, a panel of possible cross-reactive serum specimens as well. You can see that both the ELISA and the rapid diagnostic test all cross-reacted to some degree with either West Nile, yellow fever, or St. Louis encephalitis, or even rheumatoid factor. So how do we confirm this cross-reactivity? How do we decide what test is right and an immunodiagnostic test to confirm? Unfortunately, all we have is this neutralization test, which is a biological test. It is the most specific test, flavivirus serological test available to date. And in 2007, to try to standardize this test throughout the world, that we developed guidelines to help people look at like cell lines and different viral strains that should be used based on geographical regions. Although that didn't really help a whole lot. It gives people some idea of what to do, but every laboratory does something slightly different. We have lots of formats of this test as well, so comparing one format to the other is not really possible. The plaque reduction neutralization test, the fluorescent focus assay, the microneutralization test, and the TC-ID50. The neutralization cutoffs were also vary. You can see that people use 50, 70, 90, and most of the time, we at the CDC use the 90% for differential diagnostics. So there's a four-fold difference between one flavivirus compared to another flavivirus. We say that that's most likely the infecting virus. However, we have the issue of original antigenic sin. And I always like to show this because even though it's a very old study from 1993 by Kuno, and Dr. Gubler was also on this paper in Puerto Rico, he elegantly showed that the original antigenic sin story. So here he's showing that this person's first infection was dengue virus 1 and then was confirmed a dengue virus 2 infection, subsequent dengue virus 2 infection. Now, there's differences in timelines of when these were actually taken, like how many years between 1 and 2 infection. But I think the point here is to show that after only one day of testing, you see that the antibody response is against dengue virus 1. And then after 14 days post-onset of illness, the antibody response is very strong to dengue virus 1. And you do have quite a bit of response in the reciprocal titer of the neutralization test to 2560. But your biggest response is actually the very first virus that this person was exposed to. Interestingly enough, he looked at yellow fever as well, didn't see the same result. They were more specific to whatever they were infected with dengue virus 3. Now, jumping ahead, Johnson and others in 2005 did something similar with the outbreak that was happening in the Midwestern region of the United States for West Nile virus. And actually, she looked at different patients, and I'll talk about patient number 8, who has a previous yellow fever vaccination as well as a Japanese encephalitis vaccination. And they were recently infected with West Nile virus wild type in 1999. And you can see that after about a month or so post-infection, the highest titer this person had it was against Japanese encephalitis. Although it has a good titer against, say, West Nile virus, they are again displaying the original antigenic sin. And then jumping ahead a little bit further, this particular study by Van Meer and others in the Journal of Clinical Virology in 2017, they show that this cross-reactivity amongst the flavivirus, again, making it very difficult for us to actually determine which flavivirus people were infected with. What I like about this study is that it's actually done with naive travelers. So they're all dengue virus naive. But still, they saw 3 out of 10 confirmed Zika virus cases cross-reacted with dengue virus IgM, about 30%, and 5 out of the 10 cross-reacted by IgG. So 50% of those cross-reacted, even though they've never seen dengue virus previously. So now I'm going to jump into the non-structural protein NS1. So the role of NS1 in tests and differential diagnostics can be that NS1 can be a specific test to differentiate between flaviviruses. For example, Zika virus has about a 54% amino acid homology with dengue virus, and there are already specific dengue virus 1, 2, and 4 antibodies published, as well as there's recently been a test developed by a company looking at an ELISA test for each of these serotypes, ALT 1, 2, 3, and 4. So that's a possibility, and it could be a way that you could do a differential diagnostics. The other thing that you could use NS1 for was the anti-NS1 IgM or IgG to differentiate between flaviviruses. However, you typically have a lower expression of both IgM and IgG against NS1 when you compare it to what you actually have in your serum specimen for the envelope protein. So the antibody doesn't persist as well, which makes it quite difficult to really test for past infection. It can be developed as an LFA-RDT. It would be nice to have this antigen detection as well as the antibody detection to differentiate dengue virus, such as we have now, except for instead of making it against the E protein, you could make it against NS1 protein. The issue with NS1 as an ELISA test looking for acute infection is the problem that we had in the 2014 study that we did with, again, the multi-country study with WHO. And you're always going to have issues with acute versus convalescent. It's always going to be more sensitive in the acute, in the ELISA assays, and it's always going to be more sensitive in a primary infection. And this is recapitulated also with the WHO TDR study with the RDTs, showing the acute always being more sensitive and the primary infection always being more sensitive than the secondary infection. And this has to do with the inhibition of NS1 by immune complexes. So in a primary infection, there's no antibody that's blocking its ability to bind to your anti-NS1 monoclonal antibody. However, in secondary infections, as we talked about, the anamnestic response, and the high-level IgG is not just directed against envelope protein, but also directed against NS1, and it gets blocked early in the expression by polyclonal antibodies. So you typically don't see a good response for secondary infections in that test. And then again, this was shown in a publication in 2016, the percent positive by NS1 versus the IgG titer. And you could see that as your IgG titer is increasing over time, your sensitivity ability to detect NS1 goes down significantly. And the other problem with the NS1 test right now that needs to be evaluated further is that they don't perform equally by serotype. So often you'll see that they typically are developed against dengue virus 1, and then they try to see if they actually is able to bind multiple dengue virus serotypes. But so what you'll see is that often dengue virus 1 is the most sensitive, dengue virus 2 is less sensitive, and 3 and 4. And that makes sense based on phylogenetics, which 1 and 3 are more related, and then 2 and 4 are more distantly related. And the other issue with at least NS1 rapid test is that, and I refer back to this WHO study in 2009. I'm sorry, this is actually IgM. You can see that there's reader-to-reader variation by lab. So even though this is the same panel, the same lot of tests, even in this case with standard diagnostics tests, you can see as low as 45% sensitivity and as high as 70%, even though every single country had the exact same panel. So having that sort of subjective reading of these tests makes it quite difficult for interpretation and sensitivity issues. But the good news about the NS1 test is that compared to the IgM, you really see less cross-reactivity within the flavivirus family. And just another point about using rapid tests in general, I wanted to kind of demonstrate this because these are prospective clinical management studies and the lessons they've learned. And these three groups actually were trying to use the standard diagnostics test as a way to clinically diagnose dengue rapidly in the hospital settings and for clinical management. And Andreas and others, they looked at age 5 to 11. They had a sensitivity of 94% for that test. But actually, when they looked at the results from the hospital testing versus the laboratory testing of the same specimen, they saw this difference in sensitivity that we observed with the reader-to-reader variation and the country variation. And that had to do with differences due to the reader training. And unfortunately, it had no change in clinical management of the patient. They were still using antibiotics, and the physicians didn't take into account the results of the RDT. And this is going to be something that has to be sort of indoctrinated in if it's going to be used as clinical management with the physicians. Gan and others in 2014 did a study with 18 to 69-year-olds, and they got a sensitivity of that same test of 91.8%. They demonstrated no significant difference in sensitivity when using clinical definitions versus using the test or a reference test as a comparator. And the RDT did better than clinical diagnosis, so that's good. It's more specific, as you would expect. But they did not evaluate the impact or the treatment decision on this particular study. Another study by Carter and others in 2015, at ages of 1 and 8-year-olds, actually had a fairly low sensitivity of 57%. And what they were trying to do was use clinical endpoints as a covariate, such as platelet counts, vomiting, abdominal pain, but this did not improve the performance of the test. 50% of the RDT positives had co-infections, of which 25% in the study were bacterial. But positive RT result was not indicative of a final diagnostics in this scenario. And then back to more about NS1. This is a recent study by Nascimento and others in the Journal of Virological Methods, anti-NS1 IgG, and we've been talking a little bit about this and its utility to determine past infection. And you can see in this cohort study, longitudinal study, the primary infections versus the secondary infections, measuring IgG against anti-NS1 IgG, you can see that there's high sensitivity within the first year, but as you go out to 3 years, you have less and less capable of detecting anti-NS1 IgG in these patients. So I'm going to jump quickly to single specimen diagnostics. I won't go through this very deeply, but just to say that at the CDC, we were really interested in knowing, instead of requiring paired specimens to make a diagnostics, we were asking the question, can we just use a single specimen and can it tell you whether it's dengue or not? And we found that in the first 3 days of infection, RT-PCR and NS1 were quite sensitive, and you could actually most of the time detect the dengue virus infection. When you got it to 4 to 7 days, you actually need to add the IgM test to improve your probability of detecting. And then after 7 days, really there was no utility of the RT-PCR or NS1, unless you had a lot of primary infections. But in a dengue endemic region, that was not useful. And this is some of the data that we generated for that study. So when we compare the RT-PCR for, and I know you can't see this very well, but this is the CDC RT-PCR, this is sensitivity over the 10 days of infection. And we used about 1,200 specimens for this study. You can see that the sensitivity is quite good, and then you have this big drop after 5 days. And the same thing is observed with NS1. If you add NS1 to PCR, you get a little bit of improvement in the sensitivity the first 5 days, but you still see this big drop. And recall that this study was done in Puerto Rico, where dengue is hyperendemic. And then if you add PCR and IgM, you see the sustained sensitivity throughout the 10 days of infection. Now, if you look at NS1, and you can recapitulate the same results, where NS1, again, sensitivity starts dropping at day 5 quite dramatically, and you also have a lot of variance in this particular days. And then if you add IgM, you see this tightening up and sustained sensitivity throughout the first 10 days of infection. So I'm going to jump now to diagnostic tests for dengue in seroprevalence studies. And we've heard a lot about this today, about the Denvaxium vaccine and its efficacy in seronegatives versus monotypic immunity and primaries. And of course, whether you're vaccinated with yellow fever or Japanese encephalitis. And then came the SAGE recommendations in 2017. They recommended a cross-sectional serosurvey using school-based sampling to estimate the age-specific dengue virus seroprevalence to inform the countries about national vaccination programs. And in that recommendation booklet, we recommended that you evaluate the IgE ELISA to determine the sensitivity and specificity according to the population that's receiving the vaccine, and to perform receiver-operator curves with IgG and PRNT as your gold standard, and at least looking at 100 to 200 specimens. This is showing ROC analysis from a study that we did in 2013. And, of course, a lot of seroprevalence studies rely on multiple different anti-IgG ELISAs, such as the PanBio or ALIR. However, they haven't really tested the cross-reactivity, and many of them have sensitivities as low as, in this study, we found the specificity to be as low as 24%, but a very good sensitivity. And in this particular study, it was actually a traveler study in the United States, in the Boston region, and many of these people either were traveling to dengue endemic countries or actually had lived in dengue endemic countries. And they're going to this travel clinic to get some advice on what vaccinations they needed. Some of them were recently vaccinated, but most of them had already had the yellow fever vaccine. And we found that the yellow fever vaccine in this population contributed to 52% of the false positive results. And many groups also use the hemagglutination assay as well for serosurveys. As I said before, it's not isotype specific. What we've learned from seroprevalence studies is that they are informative. They help us try to figure out how much dengue is out there or how much exposure is out there. You can see that in Puerto Rico, which is a hyper-endemic country, by the time you're 18 years old, 92% of the people in this American Red Cross study that we did, where we took specimens from people who were donating blood to the American Red Cross, we found that 92% of those specimens were positive for IgG ELISA, and they were all confirmed by neutralization tests. And another study that we did to look at school serosurveys using IgG ELISA, 49.8% of the students that are ages of 7 to 18 were seropositive. In Singapore, which is an endemic country, only 10.4% were positive. In Kenya, which we don't know if it's endemic, I'm assuming it is, in a retrospective study that was done countrywide in 2007, we found 12.5%. However, this is not a fair analysis because in Kenya, most of the dengue is actually found in the coastal regions. And geographically, you don't typically find dengue in the northern regions, which is dry and arid, and even in the western Kenya regions because it's so rural. And then in Hawaii, it's not endemic. You find 7%. That was done during an outbreak in Florida. It was 6%. I won't go over this. So I've been asked many times whether you can use a rapid diagnostic test, one of the commercial lateral flow assays, to measure past infection. And these tests were not calibrated to do that. These tests were calibrated to look at that high IgG level that you see in secondary infections. So you're unable to identify any of the primary infections. And you can see that we actually used the CDC IgG ELISA for this testing. And this was the panel that we looked at for NS1 in the 2014 study that we multi-country study with WHO. You can see that 36% for standard diagnostics, 50% for CTK, 36% for ABON. This is not a lateral flow assay. This is actually a comb test. It had actually good sensitivity for IgG, interestingly enough. I don't think this test is on the market anymore. So using an IgG LFA rapid diagnostic test to try to determine past immunity is not a really good idea because these companies have actually calibrated these tests to look for recent infection. And recent infection and a secondary infections particularly, which have very high titer IgGs. So in conclusion, we can all agree that NS1 and RT-PCR are the most sensitive and specific test during early acute phases, day 0 to 3. You're typically gonna pick up one of these or both of these. The NS1 ELISA and RDTs are less reliable in the convalescent phase of the infection, and this has to do with the immune complexes that are formed due to the anamnestic response of IgG and secondary infections. The combination test has been shown in multiple studies, not just ours, and this one with IgM or RT-PCR with IgM proved to improve the detection of dengue. However, this is going to become much more difficult with Zika. We have multiple assays to look at differential diagnostics. However, they're not well standardized between groups, such as a plaque reduction neutralization test, but the NS1 test is commercially available for dengue. NS1 IgG ELISA could have utility for differential diagnostics and past exposure, but I think it would take some time to develop this test and design it properly so it's more sensitive. We could detect it further out. Because we're not sure if we're not finding IgG against NS1 because the tests are not sensitive or it's because it's just not there. So I think that needs to be fleshed out. Targeting vaccination based on seroprevalence has been shown to be relevant to achieve improved efficacy of at least one vaccine. Whether this is going to be important in the other vaccines that come on board, we don't know. So developing a diagnostic for one specific vaccine, it's unlikely that a company will do something like that. And a confirmation of IgG ELISA results by neutralization can guide the investigators of the accuracy of the IgG ELISA in the population studied, that will have to do with whether they have previous flavivirus infection or previous flavivirus vaccines. And commercial LFAs are not properly calibrated to detect past infection, especially primary infections. So with that, I'd like to thank the WHO Laboratory Network, who I use most of the data from 2009 and 2014 for NS1 and IgM evaluations of tests, as well as the dengue branch and the arbovirus disease branch, and WHO SAGE for this talk. And I'll take any questions.